Hi, Penny Randall-Davis. Fantastic to see you. Of course, we're old friends, and we've worked together for many, many years. And it's a delight to have you here. Penny, I'd love to know about your journey into singing and how it all began for you.
Thanks for inviting me, Robin. It's great to kind of be part of this dialogue. And it was lovely to watch one of your earlier interviews. It really kind of sparked quite a few things in my own history. So what got me started? Well, I was from quite a working class background in East London and went to a Catholic primary school where there wasn't much music provision. But I really loved it, and I knew that it was something in my bones that I really wanted to do. And I had a dad who was very, very into classical music. So he was great. I remember he took me to my first prom when I was about 9. Don't know how he got the tickets. And we sat quite far forward in the stalls, and he said, "You might be bored, bring a book." Brilliant idea.
Yeah.
So I took the book, and I remember being absolutely spellbound and thinking, that is what I want to do. And in fact, I had really dreamt of being a violinist, but there wasn't any provision and there wasn't any money in those days to have lessons. So
was this at the Albert Hall?
Yeah. I think he knew somebody through work.
Right.
And I remember it to this day. It was, you know, classic Scheherazade, L'après-midi d'enfant, but for a kind of 9-10-year-old. And I'd heard music at home on the record player in those days.
Yeah.
But it was just a fantastic live experience. And I remember that violinist. I remember being entranced by Scheherazade. And that really kind of gave me the bug. And he was a real Beethoven fan and was always playing stuff at home, as actually many people of his kind of environment and class were at that time. It's why, you know, in the North you get people who are crazy about opera. They've always listened to it.
Yeah.
So it was from that kind of a background, very interested in stuff, that I came and went to a convent school which also didn't provide much music, not even GCSE. So I realised quite late on that the one thing that I could do later was to train my voice.
Okay.
And I was kind of flung into a production at this school. We acquired a drama teacher who proceeded to do Gilbert and Sullivan operettas with an entirely female cast, which was bonkers. Anyway, and she was quite an inspiration for a lot of people, and she said to me, "You need to have some lessons."
It's funny how one person can inspire and trigger things, doesn't it?
Yeah, and I mean, we know that as teachers, don't we? But being on the receiving end of that in one's own life, I mean, I remember all those people along the way who said, "You should do that. You know, you're right. It fits you. It's really good." Yeah. So I was very, very grateful for that, because that might not have happened. And I sort of knew in my bones that I was a musician, but I had none of the theoretical background because I hadn't really been educated in it at all. So I knew that vocally you could train if you had a good voice. And so when I was at university, where I did English and French, I went to Durham, actually. I got some lessons. I still didn't know anything about anything, but I had some lessons from a very lovely established baritone in the Northeast called Dennis Weatherly, who was quite well known in his time. Uh-huh. And he said, "Well, if you want to audition for colleges," because all I'd done at Durham was just sing in the operatic society and ended up, you know, taking leading roles and neglecting my studies quite a lot, I think, because it was the thing I really loved. And he said, "If you want to start auditioning, I know somebody at the Guildhall." And he sent me to have a consultation with Noel Barker at the Guildhall, who was head of singing at that point. And she said, "Yeah, it's worth you auditioning for our postgrad scheme." And in those days, if you had a decent instrument, you could get in on the basis of that.
Yes. So you went to the Guildhall.
Went to the Guildhall. And then I had some more lessons in London, got a scholarship, went to Munich for about 18 months and studied privately there, which was brilliant. And then kind of got on my track, started off understudying at Scottish Opera and then taking roles there, and then you know, looking for work like everybody else, and got going on the kind of treadmill, as we call it, in terms of getting yourself out there and, you know, learning your craft, really.
Yeah.
And that carried on for some years as things, you know, snowballed.
And, of course, you sang in Sydney Opera House, didn't you?
I did. That was amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
I only found out afterwards that there was a bomb scare while I was there, and I never knew. Because they kept it really quiet from the soloists. Right. Yeah, that was
it's
like
been
the top.
Amazing singing solos there. It's been fantastic.
It was incredible. It was actually, it was in the concert hall, which has got an incredible acoustic. But the strange thing about it was that they, I don't know if you know this, they remodeled the interior after they built it, because there was an acoustic specialist who did it, and then the acoustic was really weird. Right. So they adjusted it. But even when I was there, it was lovely to sing in. But when you're in the audience, you get a kind of ch-chum, ch-chum, ch-chum going on. So they put baffles up and all sorts of things. Yeah. So recordings from there have to be really carefully managed.
Right.
So, but it was wonderful, you know, and Australia is fantastic. It was great. People were wonderful. Yeah. So that was
brilliant.
Great.
Brilliant life experience.
So
at some point your life took a turn. And so you were this hugely successful, wonderful singer, and you still are, but life took a different turn.
Yeah. So in fact, the Sydney thing was in the later phase of my life, but in the earlier phase, I was, I'd made my ENO debut and got my first job in Germany. Yeah. So things were going well, mostly in the kind of dramatic coloratura repertoire, singing Queen of the Night, because if you could do it and you looked right, it's a bit like, you know, having a cachet as an athlete, everybody asks you to do that thing.
Yeah.
So that was happening. And then I had a kind of period in my personal life where a lot of stuff happened at the same time, the major event of which was the death of my dad. Mm. And I got a bit ill afterwards. You know, it was a difficult time. And I had a fever for about 3 months. And I think probably what I had was glandular fever, but at the time I didn't know. And I went off to Germany thinking, oh, I've got flu, it'll be all right.
Yeah.
Got to Germany, started this contract, and it was clear that I actually wasn't all right. And at that point in Germany, they had no word for chronic fatigue or post-viral syndrome, which is what I actually had. So I had to curtail that contract about 4 months in because I was fulfilling my commitments, but feeling really weird in my body, and I couldn't function in between the performances. It was taking me ages to recover. Yeah. And, you know, I was in Germany on my own, so it was tough.
Yes.
And then came home and saw a specialist, and he said, you've got chronic fatigue. And I was like, well, what's that going to mean? He said, I don't know. It's open-ended. And hence began a very long phase, actually, of resting. My voice was fine, but I was extremely fatigued. And so I didn't sing for, I think, 2 or 3 years, probably, when it was at its worst. And I happened to be lucky to live in Brighton and have good friends and family and stuff. So I could always look after myself, unlike some people who have it. Yeah. But it was hard. And the hardest thing being that I was just at this point where things were really
blossoming,
opening up. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so opera companies were phoning up my agent saying, you know, can we hear Penelope for blah, blah? And he was phoning me up going, what do you think? And I'm like going, I don't know. meanwhile, I was doing everything I could to try and get better, but you can't. So you just have to wait. Anyway, so that was quite a phase, which ended up being quite long. And during that period, I remember meeting a friend of mine who's actually a GP, and he said, it's funny that you're not really doing singing, even though you're exhausted, because it's a thing that you really love.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, he is right.
So it's kind of the thing that would make you feel better, almost.
Yes. You know, duh. But I think there was a kind of a deeper thing going on about, alongside the organic medical thing about, you know, am I really meant to be a singer? Because I had never been, I'd started it all and I was doing well and all that, but I wasn't sure it was my path. Okay. But actually being silent for a few years really showed me that I did have something to say, and I really did feel it as an expression. Yeah.
So it was a case of absence makes the heart grow fonder.
Yeah, yeah, in a way, not of the kind of pressure of the world, but of the the thing itself, the expression. And so I found a teacher
Did you miss it because you missed it, or is it part of your soul that just without it you're not complete, maybe?
Both, I think. I mean, I think for me it's always been about the expression. So for me, the music is the thing. So when I was ill, I would listen to certain things. Like when I was grieving for my father, I'd listen to Vaughan Williams and Handel. I couldn't listen to anything other than Handel. And to this day, Handel is my go-to comfort, expander, joy. You know, I find everything in it. And Bach is wonderful. So both things, really. But there was something about finding my voice after that episode in my life, which was quite profound. And I found this amazing teacher in Sussex who was the daughter of my first professor at the Guildhall. And she'd been a singer herself, but very quietly for like 15 years, she'd been working holistically with voice in a completely unfated way. And she's an absolute genius. She really is wonderful. And when I went to her, when I went to her, I could hardly stand up for an hour.
Right.
So by the time
what do you mean when you say she worked holistically with voice? What does that mean?
Well, she evolved. It's not exactly a system. She evolved a body of work, which was comprised of exercises for the body and also for breath, and making sound based around the five vowels. Right. And it kind of loosely correlates with the idea of chakras and where the bases of energy are in the body. So you have a root chakra, so you have sound for that, which in this case is the oh vowel. And so there was this kind of pantheon of stuff based around sounding pure vowels,
right,
and becoming a resonator or reconnecting to your resonance, because we all have it.
Yes.
And we all know how to resonate.
Yes.
It's whether we're connected to that knowledge. But the movement itself was called First Nature because, you know, people talk about something being second nature, but her premise was our first nature is to be connected, is to resonate as human beings and as animals.
So it's almost finding your core.
Yeah, yeah. And also all the other things, not just core, thinking about feeling your environment, the quality of your hearing. So a lot of the exercises are also based in silence. So there's quite a link with contemplative practices.
Did you find you had to work at accepting that silence? Was that a challenge in itself?
Actually, I really loved it. What I had to work at accepting was I got some funding from the Musicians Benevolent Fund, who were absolutely brilliant during this period for me, and to do this 13-month training. And I like rocked up to this training with a whole load of random different people. And I was so used to being with singers. How arrogant was that? And I was like, I don't need to be doing this. What am I doing here? And, you know, within a month, I was like, I really need to be here.
Okay.
Because it was about a much more elemental connection with the sound.
So you were saying you were almost at the point at which you couldn't stand, and then you take this. So after a month, what was it in that month that made you, what was your epiphany? What made you see the light in this?
I think the whole process took longer than that, but to begin with, it was about feeling yourself as a resonating being and also accepting that and trusting that.
Okay.
So the paradigm for me is before I did that training, I was so technically aware, which I am, that I could hear everything in my own voice that I didn't like.
Yeah.
And I could hardly bear to listen to myself on recordings or whatever. When I was doing the training, I got to a point where my fatigue started to lift. Wow. And the oscillation between fatigue and being a bit energized would be less extreme. Uh-huh. And that on bad days I could sing and I could think, oh, that sounds like me, and I would start to feel better. So I kind of really did sing myself better, but it was because I'd established a connection with what I was really about, rather than this kind of tradition of excellence, which is, you know, one of the big things we've been talking about. How far does discipline and art get in the way for artists?
So it's that hard balance between having the technique that you need,
yeah,
but as you just put, singing yourself better. So that's your lifting your soul and connecting your soul with your sound.
And your body, really, yeah. Like really being in your body. Because I think one of the dangers of studying music is, sure, we have to have intention and we want to know what we want to create, but it's also spontaneous and opening, and it's a response.
Yes.
And I think when you're learning a discipline, you forget that you have to be responding to something. So singing is a communication with an audience.
Especially in a competitive environment.
Space.
Yes. Yeah.
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 Yeah. Which starves it, really. I mean, because I really think, my sort of bottom line is, I think that all human beings want to be the best they can be and want to function well. And any of the stuff that we do that doesn't do that is kind of a good motive, but possibly the wrong strategy. And I see it with young, I mean, I teach, you know, young professionals a lot. And as artists, young singers tend to expect themselves to respond in a nanosecond to something, which is good, because of course when you're on stage, you have to do that. You're in a situation and you want to be spontaneous and responsive, but if you're an animal, when you walk into a space, you sense the space. You don't just make your cry. You set your antennae out. Who's around? What's the space like? How do I feel?
So awareness is part of it.
Bit massive part. Yeah, yeah.
Right.
And I think not expecting ourselves to function out of our own timing. You know, so the best artist, I think in any genre, you know, you watch someone like Frank Sinatra, he's got, or Tony Curtis. Do I mean Tony Curtis? Not Tony Curtis. Sorry, I'm forgetting my words. Who's the other Tony? Who's the era of Frank Sinatra?
Well, I'm not sure.
Anyway, there we are. We'll have to scratch that a bit. But the age of crooners?
Yes, yes.
That thing about having loads of time and space in what you're doing,
yes,
and not driving it in a particular way.
So you found you began to heal, if you like, or you began to come up one with yourself. How did it move from you taking this and helping heal? Well, not necessarily heal, but be a therapy for others.
Well, I don't call what I do therapy, because I'm a voice coach and singing teacher, but I think sometimes the effect can be therapeutic. Yeah. So the stuff I started to do as a result of this holistic study, I then incorporated in my own technique.
Yes.
And I'd be doing these exercises, which are not like conventional la-las, as I call them, you know, la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Very, very different. They're just about pure sounding. They're about getting the levels in the body stacked up naturally so that you can resonate as freely as possible.
So does that mean that the awareness you were talking about is connecting with being aware of tensions, mm-hmm, and trying to reduce those levels of tension to increase the resonance throughout the entire body? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, it's, in a way, it's more an awareness of places you can rest. So okay. The thing we don't have is centers of gravity, places we feel like we can rest. So if our shoulders are down and we feel like our shoulders are kind of resting on our ribs, which they're not really, but we can feel that feeling, then the thoracic diaphragm across here is open, and my sternum is relaxed and I'm going to feel relaxed and my throat's going to be open. So the whole way the geography of the body stacks up can obviate tension, and then I'm free and more bell-like because the sound resounds within me, and I don't have to kind of keep sending it. I'm just singing where I am.
No, and a common penny word is space.
Yeah. On all levels.
On all levels. So tell me about space then.
Space. Well, I think that the way we take our in-breath is really important for singing. Yeah. And now we're not always going to make a massive amount of space inside the mouth, both under the hard palate and around the soft palate. But I think for many people, especially in England, the physiognomy is quite locked down, ironically. and I think actually to open the throat, then a spacious in-breath.
Yes, opening which to an is, R-shape.
Yeah. Yeah, which is kind of based on nature. It's based on a yawn or relief letting go, all those natural responses. I think it's the best softening of the system for you to take in the breath so that you can then send it dynamically in whichever way you want to. So I think that spaciousness inside us is something which is not always taught, certainly to young singers.
Yes.
And the fact that we can do that, we know how to do it already.
Yes.
Because it's all about what we're sending out. Excuse me.
But in a way, that space which you call bell-like, and when I teach young singers, I often talk about sounding like it's echoing in a cave. It's that idea, isn't it? And in a way, it's not about forcing it out. It's about echoing in ourselves, and then it just resonates out.
Yeah, and learning to trust that feeling, because of course it's always a balance that you're kind of doing this with, isn't it? There's always a different bit of the glitter ball that might be forward. So if I'm resting in the space, I think, and I'm going, then I'm not open, I'm not free, I'm stuck in a position. So it has to be a kind of composite way of feeling the whole body and the whole breath mechanism. But also for me, there's the space I'm sitting in, you know, that thing I was talking about context. Yeah. So in the holistic training, we did a lot of work with hearing and the quality of listening. One or two of which were based on Buddhist contemplative practices, where you just you practice a simple kind of mindful way of just becoming aware of what you can hear, and you kind of rest with that and try not to analyze it, and gradually the quality of hearing changes from that slightly over attentive, over driven hearing that so many of we musicians and singers have, to one which is much more all embracing and much less effortful. And that was a massive epiphany for me, really. I mean, I would equate it in the jazz world to, we might have had this conversation, you know, if you're watching a really brilliant jazz ensemble and they start improvising and you're like, how are they ever going to get back to where they were?
Yes.
And they're all just, the quality of hearing is this kind of lateral, okay, what's everybody else doing? Where am I? I'm not doing that thing of driving it forward. I'm having to stay in the texture and see how everyone else is moving.
That's interesting, isn't it? Because we the music world can be so competitive, and we want to be the best at what we do. And the nature of practicing an instrument or a voice is that you are always trying to improve. But the driving forward is sometimes the barrier. And what you're talking about is being one with yourself and being open and being resonant. And it's not driving that gets the best quality, almost.
Yeah, I mean, it's a world of paradox, isn't it? Because, of course, you know, we want to be dynamic as well.
Yeah.
And the idea is, if I'm talking about being in the space and I'm hearing, I'm not talking about not being able to really move forward quickly. It's more about, you know, if you are aware on all sorts of levels of how you are, how your breath is, what you want to say, where you are, then you can really move towards it actually faster in the end. But initially it feels like a less specific, less discipline driven thing.
Yeah.
And it's a different kind of discipline, I think.
It's more a centeredness.
Yeah.
Because you're talking, you're talking about being aware of your body, aware of what you're feeling with the chakras, aware of tension, aware of posture, and then you're talking about how that's enhancing resonance, which is enhancing the natural quality of who you are as a person.
And the sound both replenishes you, but it also reflects you. And I think the thing about, if you approach it that way, is that you come back to that thing about most people have good basic awareness, however much stuff has happened to them. And that's where the dovetail with the therapeutic approach, which you asked me about earlier, happens. Because I really do think, like, any group wants to function well. Any human physiology and emotional self wants to function well. But I think we don't cut ourselves enough slack. I think people think they're not good enough.
Yes.
They don't know how to do it. It's a thing that's outside them and not to do with them connecting with the things around them.
Do you think that's our constant fear of how other people perceive us and the fear of being judged?
I think it's partly our culture. Yeah. I mean, I think there are other cultures where, you know, we could quote them, where singing is a much less self-conscious act.
Yes.
And ironically, you know, if you step on an opera stage, what makes people wake up and connect with you is an elemental sound, which is kind of what I'm talking about. Now, in many cultures in the world, that is what you do when you're singing popular music.
Yeah.
It depends, you know, on the culture, I think. I know it's a bit of a truism, but I do think cultures where you sing and move at the same time, things like, you know, I was Googling once to look for a particular rendition of something, and I came across these Samoan choirs. Now, I sang in New Zealand, and we had a Samoan soprano in the magic flute I was in. Mm-hmm. Learned a little bit about Samoan culture through her. But if you watch Samoan choirs, they have these ritualistic movements that they do first. And so interracial choirs in New Zealand in choir competitions also do. They'll stand there and go before they start, or they'll shake their arms downwards. And it means something in the culture. Right. But everybody does it, whether they're Samoan or not. But for me, that's absolutely fabulous because, of course, it frees up the flow of breath before you've even started, and you're there creating a presence, and then you sing. It's amazing.
So when you've used what you've learned with people in the health side of your work, is that what it's about? Is it the freeing up of the breath? Is that releasing endorphins? Is it relieving positive feeling? How's that work?
All of it, I think. I mean, I think it depends on the context. So.
Yes. You've worked with people very, very, very ill, haven't you?
Yeah, I have. Yeah. When I lived in Brighton, I did quite a lot of regular work with different kinds of groups. And when I moved up here, I rolled out actually a course for people with ME, for Derwent ME Society, which was brilliant, having sort of had it.
Yes.
What was great was noticing what helped them. And these weren't people who wanted to sing. They were people who wanted to do breath work and relaxation. Uh-huh. But it did also include sound, the course. And it was really successful. And what was great was watching what simple physical adjustments helped them feel more energetic, what simple sounds made them feel more themselves. And these were people who, even to drag yourself to a class, it was hard, you know. So that was really, really brilliant. I did some work at the James Cook Holistic Care Centre with cancer survivors, and that was different again. That was a kind of more of a one-off. They asked me in to do a kind of guest session. And I think as a practitioner, it's always being aware of what setting you're stepping into and being sort of very quiet intuitively and with your body of work that you carry with you, that you also practice yourself, otherwise it doesn't work for other people, and just seeing what helps. But honestly, very often, even for people who have been quite ill, who are either rehabilitating or are ill, a mixture of real silence, real relaxation, and then really making sound really works.
Right.
You know, if people think they've got no energy, if you get them making sound, then they find they've got it. You know, it's yeah. often about yeah. it being blocked, whatever state you're in.
Right. So it's removing the blocks of tension or stress or anxiety that are preventing that resonance from occurring.
Yeah. Yeah, and from us getting benefit from the resonance, because the resonance feeds us. You know, if you knock a block of wood, the wood resonates. Everything has a resonance.
Yeah.
And, you know, the the holistic idea is that if resonance is compromised by disease, then we also then feel less well because we're not resonating completely. But if we can resonate as well as we possibly can,
then we can feel the best we can in the situation we're in.
Yeah. I mean, in fact, in one of the courses I was on, we had a woman who was dying, and she came to this training very, very regularly. It was wonderful. And she'd lie down and, you know, do things in her own way and got tremendous benefit. Also, because when you're in a group and people are kind of being their best selves, being open with each other and wanting to create a communal atmosphere, then people do entrain with each other. So that's the other thing about resonance. If I sing with somebody else and I'm resonant, I'm open to them and we're hearing each other well, then that is immensely restoring and inspiring and life-giving.
Yeah,
you know, hence our choir movement.
That's brilliant. That's brilliant. Mm. So I know that you've even though you are renowned as an operatic singer, I know you've even worked with rap artists and pop singers and all sorts. So how does this apply to different styles of music? Obviously, I mean, you've almost answered it in that you've described how it can help people who are terminally ill or extremely ill. Mm. How's it cross over?
I mean, I think the main thing is to not sort of have a set method. I think it's about having, as I said, understandings that you've evolved over time. And it's also about tremendous respect for the person you're working with, because there are people, I mean, I can remember a particular rap artist who's very talented, and he was the sort of person it would be like he was reciting poetry, and some people have this thing, they start talking and you want to start crying, and he had that thing. He could have recited the shopping list, and I'm like, oh my God. Anyway, but part of his delivery was that.
Right.
So I worked with him a little bit.
Yeah.
But like, that was his natural expression, to really kind of contort, and it was part of his sort of flair.
Right.
So you have to be quite careful to respect that and not always be thinking about the health of the throat.
Yes.
Because making somebody who like that, who's very spontaneous and very connected to themselves, have to think about how they're doing something.
Were you worried that his tension was limiting his natural flow?
Yeah. And also that he'd do his neck in on a very basic level. But, you know, he was only coming to me for a few sessions through a connection. And what he had so much resonance.
Right.
You're like, okay, I think what at the very best, you can give people choices.
Yes.
And so if you might, you know, if I had someone like that now, I might work much more with the connection with the feet and the legs and the tailbone and the sacrum and the pelvis, so that if they're contorting through here, if you actually work with the pelvis and the base of the spine, they're going to be less inclined to do that.
This is sounding almost like the osteopath's version of singing, or the alignment of the body, or the one stress in one part of the body can cause a problem in another part of the body.
Everything's
interconnected.
Yeah. I mean, with less medical know-how in my case, but that's why listening to your former conversation with Jennifer about the Alexander technique really rang a bell, because I've had that myself. In fact, I had Alexander work when I first got chronic fatigue, and it was immensely helpful. So I think there's lots of different routes into the same kind of result. And what we call it varies. But I do think that we all know how to breathe and that we all can sing.
So it's almost going back to basics. It's almost going back to what our body would have naturally done when it was a baby.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's not to minimise how sophisticated it is. Because I've been in a room with singers, and you say, so in classical singing, there are different ways of thinking about how you send the sound. The Italian technique is very much about riding the breath and sending the sound forward. The slightly older German technique will be much more about gathering the sound this way, which, so somebody like Gundula Janowitz, fantastic artist, very much about this very focused, beautiful basis for the sound, right? Now, you're in a room with a group of singers and you talk about which direction you're going to send the sound in, and they all go, well, I can't sing backwards, that's ridiculous. And then you say, well, okay, turn your back to us. And so four people, you know, turn their back to the other four. And now you want to say something to that group behind you, just say it in your head as you're singing a vowel.
Yes.
And the sound in the room completely changes because the body knows how to organize the breath.
Mm-hmm.
Not for nothing do pygmies have songs that they sound across forests, because they can't be seen. They can't see the people they're singing to, but they need to get that message across. Often it's about, you know, threat or hunting or something. So we do know how to do that stuff. And we forget, I think, which is why it's brilliant, because actually when people get reminded, they get very like, ooh, thrilled. Tony Bennett, for the sake of this recording, I've not lost my marbles.
Literally, the penny has dropped.
It has, finally, Saturday afternoon. Consummate timing.
Perfect. Well, Penny, tell us about what you're doing now and what's important to you in your life now.
Well, what I'm doing now is a mixture of work in my studio with a whole variety of people, and I love all of it, really. And also my pupils within my job at Barnard Castle School at the moment, who are lovely. I'd never really stepped into the school system until about a decade ago, and that's been really fun.
Which is where
teenagers.
We first met, pretty much.
Yeah. You know, getting into the world of teenagers and understanding their brains. It's been really fun. And it's lovely. And my studio is great. In the interim, before lockdown, I actually pursued studies in Reiki, and I'm now a Reiki master. So I was giving treatments before lockdown.
So did you find that tied really closely in with what you were already doing? Did you find a strong connection?
I did, yeah. I mean, it's an area that really interests me, because my own Reiki instructor and I, who's a kind of higher practitioner, we had started to run workshops at that point for mostly Reiki practitioners in sound and Reiki.
Yeah.
Because Reiki believes that you can channel healing through the breath. Uh-huh. And I suppose my training, one of the effects of proper resonance is that you can channel all sorts of things through your resonance, including healing. Yeah. So I had just started with people to give Reiki and make sound through that, which is probably part of what I'm probably meant to be doing, I think.
But that connection between breath and the sense of release.
And healing, you know, and intention, because Reiki is very much about sending healing through your higher self, whatever you call it, a higher energy. And I think that could be, think about how that compares with the highest delivery of some beautiful thing that you're singing in whatever situation, professional or not. It's kind of the same transmission of energy. And they can both be restoring. So that's really wonderful. But also, like, nitty gritty stuff, I get quite a lot of both colleagues of my own age who want a mentor to just help them have a garage service, who come on to Zoom from London, or, you know, I used to meet them in London to teach, or they come up here and stay and have a long weekend of concentrated lessons.
Yes, from the Stephen Covey books, I call that sharpening the saw.
Sharpening the?
The saw.
Right,
Sharpening the saw,
Absolutely. Great. Having a service.
We all need to sharpen the saw every now and then.
Absolutely, and we all, especially for singing, because the instrument is internal.
Yes, you can't see what's going on.
I mean, I still have lessons with my own teacher, who's a real influence in my life. And although I'm mostly retired now from performing, I occasionally come out of my box. But it's still wonderful to have feedback on what you're doing, and to make sure everything's in its right place.
Yes.
And especially if you're teaching a lot, your own art and needs to still be working, you know, so you need to be working on your own skills. Yeah. Absolutely. So, and I have a wonderful, wonderful coterie of different students. It's lovely. It's great. Apart from that, I'm raising spaniels.
Well, Penny.
Who are very vocal.
On that note, I would like to thank you very much for this interview, for an incredible insight into your holistic work and thank how it applies not just to voice, but to life, to healing, and how it connects with Buddhist spiritualism, with Reiki. It's been absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks for inviting me, Robin. It's been great. Thank you.